Welcome all after the break. We're starting with the next session. Now we have the next session which we are starting on the WHR available technologies and working principles. For this session, I already have Mr. Venkatakrishnan Govindrajan from ISJEC Engineering to share his thoughts on the areas of the technology available. Along with him joining would be Vivek Taneja from Thermex and Mr. Gladstone Evans from Avangarde. I would like to thank Avangarde for sponsoring the event and supporting the event so that we can, you know, run a very successful event. By the time I, bring Mr. Gladstone and Mr. Taneja on the stage, I would request Mr. Govindrajan to start his presentation.
Good afternoon, all. Can you able to see the slides?
Yes.
Okay. See, now all of our people very much know about the cement WHR past 10 years happening in the industry. Many of the installations are already available with us. We talk about some 10 years back, we are not much installation in India. Mostly we were dependent on Chinese technology. Now we are very much Indian manufacturers are available and many kind of boilers are coming out. Now I can take this opportunity, how the cement WHRB has developed, how many stages. Now we are in sixth stage, how it has developed. Just move. This waste heat, everybody aware, there are two kind of waste heats are available in cement plant. One is coming from preheated tower, another is coming from cooler. The cooler, whatever we are getting, cooler vent or mid. And preheater, it is a exhaust going to the ID fan. So there are two different heat sources and two different gas properties, which is coming in the preheater, having the tendency to very much sticky. And this available heat temperature are varying from 260 to 420. It depends on how many number of stages you are keeping in your preheater. Whether it is a six stage, you are very much able to attain in the range of 260 to 280 degrees centigrade. If number of stages come down, then automatically your gas outlet temperature going up. And cooler, whereas it is the nature of abrasive dust particle contained. And the possibility of heat is from 280 to 550. The 280, what we are talking about is the cooler vent, which is going to the pollution control equipment. Mostly the pollution control equipments are designed for 250 degrees centigrade. That time the cooler water spray will come into picture, the end of the cooler chamber. Automatically the temperature kill down to around 200 or something. So very much we are wasting the energy on that area. So this is the one area we can get the energy. Now we can go how the trends are moved. This is the traditional way. We are taking a tapping from cooler end. If that is the case, we can get the advantage of mass flow. The volume will be very high. Normally in the cooler, in the range of around 1.4 normal meter cube per kg of clinker. But in that around 0.3, we are going to take for treasury for their process. And balance is going to the vent, which is the temperature of very much in 280 to 320 when you are cut down the water spray in the cooler. So this is a mass volume wise, it is more, but heat temperature availability is very less. In that, you are selecting the pressure cycle forcefully to be lesser. It may be around 11 atta or 12.5 atta with a temperature of around 260 degrees superheated temperature or around 300 degrees centigrade. Obviously, the power output coming from this configuration is very less. And the next generation, people are trying to take the tapping at the cooler mid-tap. Obviously, the mid-tap is not a fixed location. It varies on the it is going to take a null point. After that, we are going to take midterm. This null point fixing in the cooler is a tedious job. It depends on variation of your load. It may move left side or right side. So it depends on that. So positively, we are taking an appropriate location to take a midterm. In that, we can get the better temperature in the range of around 350 to 420 degrees centigrade. It depends on the cooler. But here we are getting a volume will be lesser, 0.7 to 0.75 normal meter cube per kg of clinker. So in this case, what benefit we can able to get it, even lesser steam we are generating, but the steam enthalpy, what we are going to get it more, because we can go ahead for around 15 atmosphere pressure and elevated temperature of superheater around 400 degrees centigrade. Obviously, the power output coming out is a little bit higher than the conventional one. Then now, another nowadays people are doing in cooler ESP heart recirculation. This way, we are increasing the volume, the mid-tap only the location, but the mass flow fed into this cooler is going to increase. Normally, we are getting around 0.7, which is going to increase around 0.85. So obviously, mass flow will be more, so more energy you are going to get out in the same temperature. This is the another kind of installations. And next is important point is, nowadays people are trying to take a tapping on the, instead of null point on the negative side, we are there trying to take before the null point. There we can get an advantage of higher temperature, something around 500 to 550 degrees centigrade. So it can be giving a very good heat rate, even though the volume is lesser. This volume can be a better way with the hot air with the recirculation from the ESP air, and mass flow will be little bit increased, and you can maintain in the range of around 0.75 normal meter cube per kg of clinker. In this case, you can get the advantage of 500 to 550. Even you can go ahead for this pressure rating of something around 18.5, 19 atmosphere, and the temperature of something around 460, 480 degrees centigrade. Obviously, per megawatt, steam consumption will come down in the range of around 5.4 in the case of ACC, 4.9 in the case of water-cooled condensers. So obviously, power coming out from this configuration is better. This also, the same case, cooler mid-tap, with the recirculation, but this mid-tap is closer to the recuperative zone. So you are getting a high temperature, but lesser volume. This is, in this case, people are doing it, I think nowadays, three people are already in the process. We are also executing one thing with the Dalmia people, and some more people, they are doing this configuration. What we can do, the it will help better cooler balance. One tapping we are taking around a high temperature zone after the tertiary air duct, something around 500 to 550 degrees centigrade. And another tapping will be end tap or a little bit away from the mid tap. So that way you can utilize the total hot air available in the cooler. So yeah, from the cooler, it was easily get the high heat energy, and the end tap will support only for generating your evaporation purpose. The temperature is sufficient. This is also obviously a good option. And sixth case is mid-tap and end-tap with hot air recirculation. Hot air recirculation, obviously your mass volume going to get in the end-tap. Rest of the things remain same like earlier configuration. This we are taken one case study, how it is behaving. In conventional method, same area, this is worked for the 6000 TPD. How much power can be get in the case one? This is a cooler end tap and mid tap with a conventional model. The temperature of something around 280 to 320, we are going to get only 6.5 megawatt. And second one is the mid tap option, around 7.5 megawatt with the same 6000 TPD available gas quantity. when we are implementing the hot air recirculation in these, it will come something around 8.5 because of the mass volume. But only problem here, fan, additional fan power is required and wear and tear issues little bit expected. And fourth case, this is a cooler midtap with a hot air generator. See, this hot air generator help you to increase the inlet air temperature in the AQC boiler. But here the drawback is you need additional fuel. For a thumb rule, I'm giving you one of the installation we are doing now. It is going to be commissioned in Chettinadu. The amount of coal we are going to burn is 1.92 metric ton, which will impact it. It is a 9000 TPD plant. Without this HAG, that heat energy available is possible to generate only 15.25 megawatt. Whereas I'm adding 1.9 ton of coal, I'm able to generate 19.05 megawatt. So this is a better option, but those who are not having a captive power, this will be a better option because you are going to spend additional fuel on this case. And obviously, this power will be more, even you can increase also, but additional fuel. And recuperative zone tapping, it will give something around 8 megawatt. Cooler mid tap with the hot air recirculation, something around 9.5 megawatt. Again, this investment cost, wear and tear, these things are drawback. And mainly, we can move to the problems what normally the cement WHR the people are facing. Main problem is you might have aware many of the plants, the pH boiler buckling was happened that due to poor design of the casing. The casing design pressure is very much important. Normally it is fluctuating to 800 to 1200. If you are designing the casing is in that range, obviously the stiffener quantity will be more, the buckling can be avoided. This is critical point. I hope nowadays not having such a problem. Earlier it was a lot of problem like that buckling in the casing. Then air ingress. Yes, air ingress possibility in the preheater boiler is much higher because of we are using a hammering system. Hammering system contains a lot of striking rods which is penetrating the casing. So you are making a holes in the casing, you are making a platform to enter the air in the casing. That striking rod location has to be arrested properly, sealed properly. That is the only possible way to come out with this air ingress in the pH boiler. We are using specially in the double sealing arrangement for hammering rod. We can prove also in our steel cement, we achieved around 1.1% in the preheater boiler air ingress. And availability issue in the hammers, that is a critical point. Again, the hammer failure normally happen in the preheater boiler. It due to the material selection and load pattern, how you are selected to your striking rods and what kind of stuffing box you are using. We are using a stuffing box for reducing the noise reduction. Our hammering system will give the less noise, less noise compared to others. And erosion, normally this problem facing in the AQC boiler, it has the abrasive tendency. So suitably you have to select the lesser velocity for the heat transfer surfaces. And sacrificing tubes is important to distribute the tubes, distribute the hot air into your system properly. Sleeves and at the end, because in the AQC boiler most of the tubes are finned surface. It has the resistivity to maintain the abrasive, avoid the abrasiveness. But the areas which is penetrating in the casing is a easy possibility for erosive. To avoid that, the proper sleeves to be provided on this case. And again, the problems, main problem facing in cement recovery, tube leakage. Tube leakage, mainly many reason on that, maybe a wrong design, velocity factor, and material selection onwards, it has to take care properly, and manufacturing method also properly, and real-time radiography has to do for this case to avoiding the punctures, because it is a very big installation. Any punctures or leakages happen to attend that, it is a tedious job in the cement recovery. So it has to take care from this manufacturing stage onwards. This construction quality, it's everybody has to keep the proper quality plan to avoid any issues during execution, during manufacturing. But apart from that, other factors affecting this thing, steam cycle, what pressure cycle you are selecting is a art to generate a higher megawatt. Steam power process, it has to combinedly think over. It is not you are a boiler manufacturer, you are giving the gas, I am going to give this much steam. It has to think about all the aspects. A QC boiler tapping location is important. That is the reason I tabulated this case study, where we are taking a tapping, what energy we are going to get. So that is the reason tapping technology is important, where you are going to take and how much power you are going to get it. And pressure drop on the gas cycle, gas or a hot air cycle. That is important because most of the plants are not designed for the higher pressure drop. Most of the plants not having that thought to install the recovery. Now we have to install the boilers, this kind of power plant, with the available margin in the existing ID fan. So this pressure drop has to properly design, and ducting philosophy also to suit that, to maintain the existing fan pressure margin. And plant layout, obviously it has to arrive with the help of supplier as well as the client, optimum location to avoiding the gas side pressure drop in case of ducting, steam side pressure drop in case of turbine location. All these points, if we are taking care, the payback of the plant come into attractive one. This is some of the installation done by ISGEC, Steel Cement, Chettinadu, and Bharathi Cement. Dalmia is ongoing, Ultratech also ongoing. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Govindraj. I hope you are safe. வீட்டுல எல்லாத்தையுமே நல்லா இருக்கு சார். So I'll request Gladson to come on the stage. I will request him to unmute his webcam and microphone.
All are audible, right? My voice is okay.
We are audible. நீங்க நல்லா இருக்கீங்களா சார்?
நல்லா இருக்கும் சார். Good to see you, to talk in our native language.
I'm from your place. Chennai is my born city.
Oh, good. Super. Hope you are able to see my screen.
Yes, you can start with your presentation.
Yeah. So, good afternoon to all. So, we thank Mission Energy to give the opportunity to share our experience with respect to the sediment plant waste heat recovery system. So before going into the actual presentation, I would like to talk a little bit about our company and our experience. We have Avangard Engineers and Consultants and Avangard Systems and Control. With both the companies, we do the consultancy and detail engineering service for Indian projects. And we have one company at Sharjah, where we do all the consultancy and detail engineering projects for abroad clients. Then we started in 1990, and right now we have completed 30 years of experience. Then these are our four directors who have bought the Lifetime Achievement Award in various industries, including cogeneration and waste to energy power plants. And we are ISO 9001:2015, and we have ISO 17020, and we are accredited by the Consultancy Development Center. And we have ASME S-Stamp, one of the first consultant to have this in India. And we have almost around 15 departments, and each department having around 10 to 20 engineers, and we have around 250 plus professionals working in our office, and we have executed more than 2000 plus projects with 500 plus clients. This shows most of our projects are repeated projects, and we have done projects in 40 different countries. And our major area of business is power consultancy on any type of power plant, mainly cogeneration, independent power plant, captive power plant in various industries, cement, steel, chemical industries, then biomass based power plant, municipal solid fat power plants, waste heat recovery, high temperature, low temperature, like steel and cement plants, then DG set based waste power plants and the gas turbine based power plants. Then also we have a boiler design department where we do various specific boilers like traveling grate, ABC, CFBC, waste heat recovery, vinesh fired, oil and gas fired. And we give this design to various suppliers who doesn't have in-house design capability. Then certain critical components alone we do supply. And then we have done solar lot of consultancy for solar power plants, then consultancy for wastewater treatment plant, ESLD power plants, ESLD plants, effluent treatment plants, desalination plants. Similarly, we have done some process plants like distillery and ethanol plants, then bio-CNG plants and sugar plants. These are our various experiences. And overall, we have done a cumulative capacity of around 7,000 megawatt related projects, and around 3,000 megawatt amount of projects are under various stages of implementation. Then coming to a specific experience to the cement plant, we have executed almost 33 CPPs in cement industry with a cumulative capacity of around 1,085 megawatt. And around 10 cement plant waste heat recovery projects with a cumulative capacity of 95 megawatt. And right now we are doing 5 cement waste heat recovery projects with a cumulative capacity of 78 megawatt. And we have done a feasibility study for ORC based power plant in a cement industry. And we have executed 2 Kalina based cement plant waste heat recovery projects. I think throughout the country, if you see, we have experience throughout the world. If you see, we have the only consultant who have experience in Kalina-based cement plant waste heat recovery system. Then apart from that, we have done so many DPR and feasibility studies for cement plant waste heat recovery and CPPs. And another interesting thing is we have done study for biomass addition in the existing ABC and CFBC boilers. And we have almost carried out nearly completed 3 or 4 plants, and a few plants are under progress. And we do FGD and DNOX consultancy and detail engineering services also. Right now we are executing 3 FGD projects of capacity of single large capacity of around 500 to 650 megawatt. Then solar PV based power plant in cement plants and various other plants. ESLD in the cement plants, and also we do a specific study of electrical system study in process industries. Then waste heat in the cement process. As all of you know, almost the cement plant is a very energy intensive industry. Almost 40 to 50% of the production cost is because of the energy, comes from the energy. Then almost 30 to 40% of the heat is lost in the cement plant, which can be easily recovered. And now if you see the power plants, the cement plants, most of them, they do lot of energy efficient technologies and energy efficient equipments. And previously, if you see 10, 15 years back, the specific energy consumption is around 850 kilocal per kg. And right now with the, new technologies, we are able to reduce to around 700 and even still lower kilocal per kgs. And now this utilizing heat from the waste heat is gaining a momentum across the globe. So before going into this, why should we require the waste heat? One, we know that there is a fast depletion of fossil fuels, and they say that these fossil fuels are available only for maybe a few years. So our future generation, we do not know whether these fuels will be available. So any amount of fuel that can be saved by utilizing alternative energy, that is always welcome. So if you, for example, if you can generate 1 kilowatt through some waste heat recovery, you can save 0.7 kg of fuel. So by implementing an effective waste heat recovery or implementing a renewable energy source, considerable amount of coal or the fossil fuels can be saved, which can be effectively utilized for various process industries and for our future generation also. Similarly, another one major aspect is your our environmental related issues. Here again, 0.35 kg of CO2 can be saved if you can generate 1 kilowatt of power from the waste heat recovery source. So any amount of CO2 emission decrease is always an accepted proposal. So considering all these points, this waste heat recovering the waste heat becomes very important in the current globe. Then in the cement plant, there are mainly two areas where the considerable amount of heat is wasted. One is at the preheater exhaust, and other at the clinker cooler exhaust. So preheater exhaust, depending on the efficiency of the preheater system, it varies from anywhere from 260 degrees to 400 degrees centigrade. Whereas in clinker cooler, it varies from 250 to 440 degrees centigrade. Earlier, people used to take heat from the end tap, that is from the exhaust circuit. And now get more power output, people take from the mid tap, people take with single tap, with the dual tap, with so many systems are available. But our this thing is, first preference should be given for the effective cement production. Whatever efficiency method the cement has to be produced, we have to give more importance for that. Then whatever waste heat is available, you have to produce the power. Then another, there is a third heat available, which is under research and developments are yet to materialize. There is a lot of radiation heat available in the kiln, and kiln being around 85 to 100 meters long, sufficient quantity of heat, considerable quantity of heat, radiation heat is lost. So that heat also can be saved and utilized in a effective way. So in the cement waste heat recovery circuit, if you see in the preheater circuit, previously there were maybe 10-15 years back, there are 4 cyclones. Then they went with the 5 number of cyclones. Now the latest is around 6 numbers of cyclones. So more number of cyclones, your energy efficiency in the cement plant is better. Whereas in power side, more efficient, more number of cyclones, your power generation will be less. For example, when you take a 4 cyclone preheater system, your heat content is around 184 roughly kilocal per kg of clinker. When you come to the well-efficient system of 6 cyclones, it drops down to 140 kilocal per kg of clinker. Similarly, when you see the clinker cooler side, you have first generation coolers, second generation cooler, and third generation coolers. Higher the generation, your cooler recuperative efficiency is higher, whereas the waste heat available is lesser. Then power generation potential depends on, I think this all the speakers have covered on this subject. Anyway, I will rush through it. One, it depends upon the gas volume, temperature, and composition of the preheater gas. Then again, it depends on the hot volume, hot air volume, and temperature of the clinker cooler exhaust. Then again, the configuration of the clinker cooler system, whether we go for a end tap or mid tap or dual tap, depends on that, your power generation varies. Then moisture content in the raw material, moisture content in the fuel, more moisture content in the raw material and fuel, more heat has to go from to the for drying of this, and thereby the power generation will reduce. Then efficiency of the cyclones, then excess air and air filtration, air ingress into the system also affects the power generation. Then improper insulation, that higher radiation loss also will affect your power generation. So in general, as a thumb rule, you can say for a rough estimation, see this, the power generation from the cement plant ranges from 25 kilowatt per ton of clinker to 45 kilowatt per ton of clinker. This 25 or 45 depends on whether it is a 4-stage, 5-stage or 6-stage. When it is a higher number of stage, it comes closer to 25 kilowatt per ton. And if it is a lesser number of cyclone, it goes to 45 kilowatt per ton. So your power generation varies anywhere between these two lines. That we have to, it varies from plant to plant. We have to study, carry out a detailed analysis. And for a specific plant, the specific generation has to be worked out. So if you see that, normally in a cement plant, 100% of, if there is no waste heat recovery, the complete electricity has to be imported either from the grid or it should be captively generated from the captive power plants. But by going for the effective waste heat recovery system, around 20% of the power can be met in-house and only 80% of the power has to be produced externally. Then variation in power output. Assume that we have designed a waste heat recovery power plant, and what are all the factors which affects the output? One, moisture in raw meal, then moisture in coal, moisture in ash. Because for any design, we take a particular point. But if there is a variation in those moisture, the power output varies. Then false air ingress into the system. When you see the boiler arrangement, you have lot of wrapping system and there are a lot of penetration points into the boiler through which a lot of false air enters into the system, which to some extent affect the power output. Similarly, there's a bypass damper is available. The improper installation of the bypass damper or due to lack of maintenance in the bypass damper, most of the gases pass through the bypass without producing effective power. Then ineffective wrapping system. When the wrapping system in the boiler is not efficient, lot of ash accumulation takes place on the tubes, which affects the heat transfer and it will affect the steam generation and in turn the power generation. Similarly, clinker dust carryover and clinker bed thickness in the cooler also affect your power generation. Then variation in the temperature profile due to process fluctuations in the preheater and the clinker cooler circuit. Mainly, there is a lot of temperature fluctuation in the clinker cooler, which affects the power generation. Next is the seasonal variations. Because of the seasonal variation, again, it is similar to the point number one. The moisture content in the raw meal and coal and ash goes up. So a lot of heat you have to give it to that, reducing the power output. Then what are all the various waste heat recovery systems available? One, mainly the waste heat recovery systems can be categorized into two. One, it is independent power generation. And second, it is an integration with the existing CPP. The independent power generation, we have steam-based Rankine cycle, organic Rankine cycle, and ammonia-based Rankine cycle, which is called as Kalina cycle. Then you have integration with the existing CPP. Suppose if your kiln capacity is lower and you don't want to go for a extensive power plant, and if you have an existing CPP, you can use this heat to heat your feed water in the CPP. Similarly, you can generate low pressure steam for your deaerator, and you have another system. You can generate low pressure steam and inject into your CPP turbine, provided your turbine is designed for that. Or if you are going to install a new cement plant, you can integrate the CPP and this waste heat recovery steam, and you can inject into the turbine. So these are the various waste heat recovery systems available. So first we will see about independent power generation, that is steam Rankine cycle. I think almost 99% of the waste heat recovery power plants across India, people go with the steam-based Rankine cycle. I think all of us are aware, and most of the section this system is covered. And in this steam-based Rankine cycle, there are three types of system. One is a single pressure system, then a flash evaporator system, and then the dual pressure system. So in single pressure, normally if your preheater temperature is high, we can recover the complete heat by going for a single pressure. When the preheater temperature is lower, because of the pinch point limitation, the complete heat cannot be recovered by single pressure. At that condition, maybe you have to go with the flash evaporator system or a dual pressure system to recover the complete heat. So this flash evaporator system is similar to the single pressure system. Only thing is, from the boiler feed pump outlet or from the economizer outlet, you take a part of feed water and then you flash it in an evaporator, sorry, a flasher. And a low pressure steam will be generated that you will inject into the turbine. Here the problem is, since it is a flasher, there is a possibility of moisture carryover in the turbine, which is dangerous for the turbine. So normally these flash evaporator systems are available, but it is not a foolproof system. Then you have a dual pressure system, that you will have one steam generation at around maybe around 10 kg to around 15 kg depending on the heat source. And there will be another pressure cycle which is around 3 kg or 2 kg depending on the heat content available. And there will be two input. One is a medium pressure steam which will be injected, and there will be a low pressure steam which will be injected at the lower stages of the turbine. So the dual pressure are more efficient. More power generation can be achieved by dual pressure cycle. If you see a comparison, if you take single pressure as a base, flash evaporator 2 to 3% higher power can be generated. In dual pressure, around 5% higher power can be generated compared to the single pressure. Then capital cost, definitely dual pressure will be highest. Complex system, flash evaporator is more complex. When compared to single pressure, dual pressure is complex, but it is a well-established system. Internal power consumption, your dual pressure will be higher. Then life of the steam turbine, this flash evaporator is less, because during upset condition, there is a possibility of moisture carryover to the turbine. And single pressure, dual pressure will be same. Piping system, flash evaporator is more complex. And when compared to single pressure, dual pressure is a bit complex. Operation flexibility, flash evaporator is more complex, and all other things are in same lines. Maintenance, flash evaporator is high. Other two are of equal maintenance. Then what are the advantages and disadvantages of steam Rankine cycle? One, it is a well-proven system. It is widely available. There is no restrictions in this technology. All the equipments are sourced internally. Then the working fluid is water and steam, which is inert, non-toxic, well available, and its properties are well established. And one of the limitation is there's a pinch point. See, this is one of the limitation in the steam Rankine cycle. Because of the pinch point, your power generation will be slightly lesser when compared to the other technologies. Similarly, restriction on the part load operation. When below a particular load, you will have operational difficulties. And these are better payback if the capacity is higher, more than 5 megawatt. then full-time operators, depending on the local regulations, your availability is a little lower because there are statutory requirements that you have to shut down the unit once in maybe for about 15 days in a year. Then multiple pressure system can be adopted. Flexibility in combining the system with other high capacity steam-based power plants. So you can combine this system with your existing CPPs. Then another thing, it requires an extensive feed water conditioning system. So your chemical expense is high. Your space requirement is high when compared to all other systems. And cost per megawatt is less when compared to the other system. The next is the organic Rankine cycle. So organic Rankine cycle is similar to the steam Rankine cycle, but only thing is instead of the working fluid water, here some organic fluid is considered. And the selection of organic fluid is very critical in the case of organic Rankine cycle. See, lower the heat source temperature, maybe there are depending on your heat source, you have to select the material. If you have propane, N-butane, N-pentane, hexane, so many octane, so many organic fluids are there which is selected depending on your source temperature. And here there are two circuits available. One is a thermic fluid circuit, which is circulated in the hot gas circuit. And this gives heat to the organic vapor which runs the turbine. These systems are more popularly used in abroad in few countries. Here, the advantage is it's a proven system for low temperature heat recovery. More make your cement plant more effective, the temperatures for waste heat recovery will be less. Under that condition, you can think of ORC system. No restriction in using this technology. There are limited Indian suppliers. Mostly the equipment has to be imported. That is one limitation. And working fluid should be selected based on the temperature levels. Another major advantage is a pot load operation will be very effective in case of organic Rankine cycle. And no regulations, like you have to shut down the plant once in a year for 15 days. Such regulation is not there. So your availability will be very high. Simple start and stop procedures, very quiet operation, and it can be 100% automated, unattended operation. Auxiliary power consumption is very high because there are two fluid is being circulated and very compact size compared to all other systems. Effectively heat can be recovered. Then the condenser will be operating at above atmospheric pressures. So there is no vacuum applications. Another drawback is the working fluid is toxic and inflammable. So higher safety is required while operation. Then available in modular systems, normally in 2 MW module, 3 MW module. So multiple modules are available. Single higher capacity system is not available, but it can be tailor-made. Then cost per megawatt is higher when compared to the steam Rankine cycle. And another system is the Kalina-based system. That is the working fluid, instead of water, it is ammonia and water mixture. Here one of the major advantages is, depending on your waste heat available, the concentration of ammonia can be altered. So, and that is one. Second, unlike other systems, the evaporation takes place at a constant temperature. Evaporation and condensation takes place at constant temperature. Whereas here, so your pinch limitation is applicable for the other systems. Whereas here, since the evaporation and condensation takes place at a variable temperature, that limitation of pinch is not applicable for this system. So higher power can be generated by the Kalina system. But the problem is it is a patented technology. You have to take permission from the technology supplier to install this. And the working fluid is ammonia water, which is also a toxic and higher safety is required. And as I told, evaporation condensation takes place as a wide temperature difference. So no limitation on the pinch point. And pot load operation is also very effective, like ORC system. And power developed is slightly higher compared to all other systems. And cost per megawatt is also higher when compared to the other systems. And second one is the integration with the existing CPP. This is also one area where which is gaining importance. See, in some small capacity cement plants, like less than 3000 TPD plants, installing a separate waste heat recovery power plant will not be economical, or your initial cost will be very high. Under that condition, you can use the heat. If you have a CPP, you can use the heat in the existing CPP by replacing the HP heaters, LP heaters, and the deaerator. By doing that, considerable amount of coal which can be saved. Thereby, you can recover the complete waste heat in the cement plant. Similarly, when you go for a new waste heat recovery cement plant, including the CPP, even you can think of generating low pressure steam, and instead of investing on a separate turbine hall and everything, you can take the low pressure steam and inject in your CPP turbine at a appropriate location, so that your overall cost can be less, but whatever the complete recovery of the waste heat can be utilized. The advantages of this: it is simple and cost effective system with better payback when optimally configured and no heat recovery possible, no heat recovery from the waste gas if CPP is under shutdown. Due to some reason, if the cement plant has to operate and CPP has to shut down, in that condition, you cannot recover the heat. This is one drawback. Then extent of heat recovery depends on the CPP configuration. So this configuration is possible if CPP is closer to the cement plant waste heat recovery source. So this again, when you go for a new cement plant with a CPP complex, this can be properly planned and implemented. Oh, 1 minute. So next, another type of new concept in heat recovery is the heat recovery from the rotary kiln. See, this lot of radiation heat is wasted in the rotary kiln, where the temperature varies from 150 to 400 degrees centigrade. So, and this is a continuous loss of heat, which can be captured by placing some panels where you can supply the load from the turbine. If you have a CPP, from the turbine condensate the water at 40 or 60 degrees, you can pass it through this and raise the temperature up to 100 degrees centigrade, thereby increasing the efficiency of the turbine and reduce the fuel consumption. Around 3 to 3.5 kilowatt per meter square of heat can be captured by means of this technology. Similarly, this heat can be captured, and even you can produce power by means of ORC or Kalina type of systems. But these are yet to be implemented. But thing is, your initial cost is very high, and it is under research and development stage. So I think with this, I will stop my presentation. And before concluding it, finally, by going for the waste heat recovery system leads to, for an industry, it is a reduced energy bills, increased competitiveness, increased productivity, then improved quality, and increased profits. Similarly, when you compare for our nation, it is reduced energy import, conservation of limited resources available, and it is an improved energy security. Similarly, across the globe, reduced CNG and other gases emissions, and it maintains a sustainable environment. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Evans. This was a lovely presentation, and I am sure the audience would like to give. They have already been giving a loud of applause there. Before we proceed further, I would like to invite Arunesh Bharati to give a small presentation here. Yeah, Arunesh is now working with JSPL, that is Jindal Steel and Power Limited. He is distinguished alumni of NIFFT Ranchi and INSTEAD France. Extremely passionate about steel. He started his career with Tata Group and currently working JSPL, as I said, as a general manager and office of the managing director. He has also worked with blast furnace projects, shop floor operations on marketing and sales, business intelligence, strategy, and strategic affairs. Mr. Arunesh is also a member of World Steel Association Economic Committee and distinguished member of Steel Association of working with the as a working committee. Now, I would request Arunesh to give a small presentation on a very interesting subject, which is very close to not only his heart, but to the heart of the entire nation. Arunesh, before you proceed, I would request you to pause your presentation a while. I would like to share something with the audience. This video clip, which I'll share with you, this is in close to my heart, close to the heart of Honorable PM. And just watch this video before we proceed further. Arunesh, I'm sorry for that. Can you just, unshare okay. your slide, please?
Okay, just a sec. Yeah. प्लीज
रोजगार मिलेगा एक प्रकार से गरीबों की सेवा का काम कोयले से भी हो सकता है इसका विश्वास पैदा होगा यानी हर सेक्टर पर एक पॉजिटिव असर देखने को मिलेगा और मैं जो फील कर रहा हूं इसके कारण हमारे देश के गरीब इलाकों के और गरीब लोगों के सबसे ज्यादा आशीर्वाद हम सबको मिलने वाले हैं साथियों कोल रिफॉर्म्स करते समय इस बात का भी ध्यान रखा गया है कि एनवायरनमेंट की रक्षा का भारत का कमिटमेंट कहीं से भी कमजोर न पड़े कोल से गैस बनाने के लिए अब बेहतर और आधुनिक टेक्नोलॉजी का हम प्रयोग करना चाहेंगे और टेक्नोलॉजी आ पाएगी कोल गैसिफिकेशन जैसे कदमों से एनवायरमेंट की भी रक्षा होगी कोयले से बनने वाली गैस का उपयोग ट्रांसपोर्ट और कुकिंग के लिए हो पाएगा यूरिया और स्टील मैन्युफैक्चरिंग से जुड़े उद्योगों को प्रमोट करेगा हमने लक्ष्य रखा है कि साल 2030 तक 2030 तक यानी कि इस दशक में करीब 100 मिलियन टन कोल को गैसिफाई किया जाए मुझे बताया गया है कि इसके लिए 4 प्रोजेक्ट्स की पहचान हो चुकी है और इन पर करीब करीब 20,000 करोड़ रुपए इन्वेस्ट किए जाएंगे
दिस वॉज ए हार्ट टचिंग वीडियो विच इज क्लोज टू माई हार्ट दिस इज ऑलमोस्ट अबाउट ईयर मंथ बैक अरुणेश आई थिंक A month and a half back. Now, abreasting all, this is not only 4 projects, but there are going to be many other projects which are going to be lined up for that. Mahanadi Coal Field has already floated a EOI for coal to liquid in one of the mines last month. This month, in fact, 14th of August, and the EOI is going to open on 15th of September. Looking at 100 million tons of coal, and my personal goal is to see 10 gasifiers working in our country, and then I retire or I either go to graveyard. Yeah, Arunesh, I would like you to continue further.
Thank you, Ashwinji, for the nice introduction. Well, I am just trying to share the presentation once again. Ashwinji, is it visible to all of you?
Yes.
Okay. Well, thanks a lot for the nice introduction, and I am a firm believer that you always be the driving force for this coal gasification, which was later picked up by anybody. You know, so you are the kind of trendsetter in the industry. I would like to congratulate you personally and the Mission Energy from whole of my heart. Right.
Thank you. That's the reason we have spent 12 years promoting gasification industry. Today, you tell me, proud, I'll bring to you, aapke kadmon pe laake chhod dunga.
Thanks a lot. So as Prime Minister has stressed upon the coal gasification, this is the kind of technology of the time, you know, and to harness the India's coal reserve, which is third largest in the world, in a cleaner and greener way. So this is a clean technology wherein means nobody is talking about coking coal or coal, so to speak. Everybody is going away from coal. But here is the technology which can, you know, can be utilized to harness the Indian coal reserve, the biggest reserve, for its prosperity in a very cleaner and greener way. And as my first slide suggests, it's absolutely green technology. And if you see the curve here, by using this technology, the CO2 emission will be going down. So there is a reason for the sustainable prosperity of India by using our assets. The things started when Prime Minister was in US last September 19, probably, wherein CNN correspondent was asking how you are actually going to burn the coal in a cleaner way. So I just wanted to play the video. So the things started, you know, Prime Minister was stressing upon this cleaner way of utilizing coal during his US visit last September. But our chairman, Mr. Naveen Jindal, you know, he visited Sasol in South Africa, which is having a similar kind of facility. And once he came back, he sat together and started dreaming about this kind of, you know, production facility for making steel. So for JSPL, this journey started in 2000, long back, I would say around 20 years back. Later on, you know, we hunted for the technology suppliers and all. And the plant was started in 2007 and it was commissioned in 2014. So here is the project what JSPL is having. You know, you can see in the right hand side, there is a gasification unit, then the gas cooling unit. There is a rectisol unit, ammonia recovery unit, tank farm, you know, phenosolvent unit. We can recover the sulfur. We can recover the, you know, the gas and leakers separately. So here is the outline of the plant, what we are having in JSPL Angul location. This is a night view of the plant. You can see this kind of synergy between this kind of plant and the petroleum complex if you have ever visited. So it's a beautiful plant out of the greenery and looks great to visit, and it's a very picturesque actually. This is the plant, in our JSPL Angul, we are utilizing the syngas to make DRI. And we are proud to state here that this is the first in the world of its kind, wherein CGP, coal gas, is being utilized for manufacturing of the DRI. The CGP capacity is 225,000 normal meter cube per hour, and the DRI plant is having around 2 million ton of capacity. So you can see this kind of beautiful within the greenery the plant is situated. This is the gasification unit, wherein which is the actually mother of the plant. This is the gas cooling unit. This is the gas liquor separation unit. This is a rectisol plant. This is a phenosolvent plant. The left side is ammonia recovery unit, and the right side is sulfur recovery unit. This again is sulfur recovery unit. So what we believe that the coal gasification is expanded opportunity for India, not only for its prosperity, but also for employment generation. So first of all, we should address why gasification is important for India. As Prime Minister has already stressed upon, this is a cleaner way, clean technology. And we have got the third largest coal reserve, as he said earlier. So to harness, God has bestowed a huge coal reserve, and how to utilize it in a cleaner way, environmental friendly way, so that we can reach to the prosperity. The second point is that recently Prime Minister Modi has given an Atmanirbhar Bharat kind of vocal for local and Atmanirbhar Bharat campaign. You know, the way we are utilizing gasification as a means to produce steel, that is an import substitution. India today is importing around 240 million ton of coal, including the metallurgical coal, which is not available in India. And we are fully dependent on the oil and gas imports. Together, the import bill in FY19 was $245 billion. And if you can see the kind of current account deficit during FY19, it was only $54 billion. So suppose if by utilization of the domestic coal, Swadeshi coal, if we can cut down the import of metallurgical coal by utilizing the gas to produce steel, and by utilizing the gas to produce the different coal chemicals, diesels, jet fuels and all, and if we can do it around 30%, so we'll be export surplus country. So the $54 billion bridge will be gapped easily, filled easily, and that much money, that much of the foreign currency, what we will be saving, that can be utilized for the betterment of the society. The third point is that we can convert the low value feedstock, as all of us know that India is having high ass coal available. So these are all the low feedstock, converting the low feedstock to high value product is what the coal gasification is. And definitely it will ultimately create prosperity for India. It will create employment, which is much needed. And the mines are located in the remote areas like in Chhattisgarh, Odisha, Jharkhand, or wherever. These mines are located in the underdeveloped area. So there will be if this kind of gasification will be allowed, or pit head gasification will be allowed, and it will be a trend of the market. So the employment and the project will be created on those area which is remotely located, and the local youth, local people will be utilized, and it will be giving an economical thrust to those society. The second part of the presentation is, the gasification value chain. We can, in the left side, if you see, we can utilize the low variety of the coal available in India, pet coke, which is one of the byproduct of all the refineries, even used tire, or even the municipal waste, and we'll be feeding it as a raw material for the gasification process. And the gasification, out of the gasification process, we'll be getting the synthesis gas, we call it syngas, which is essentially hydrogen and carbon monoxide. That can be utilized for iron ore reduction, DRI making. That can be separated into hydrogen, which can be utilized for ammonia and urea production. That through the Fischer liquid process, it can be converted to jet fuel, diesel, naphtha, waxes, PVC, LLDP, HDP, all the olefins, set of olefins. It can be directly utilized for power generation, steam generation. It can be utilized for other oil and gas based chemicals, like we can produce it, carbon monoxide, CO2, oxygen, nitrogen, argon. We can produce SNG, methanol, ethanol, and all set of the downstream chemical. So why this is important? Because anybody can now correlate that we can, by gasification, we can be independent, we can be self-sufficient, we can be Atmanirbhar as far as oil and gas imports are concerned. So in order to develop the ecosystem, so because as of now, the industry is in the very primitive shape in India, to develop the ecosystem for gasification, we need certain strategic move. The first of all is the government of India's policy support in this regard. Second one is the coal mine allocation. Third one is the financing, because this is a kind of capital intensive a project. So we need to have a dedicated financing kind of support from government. The third one is the coal availability as a reasonable cost. And then the technology vendors. So out of India, there are so many technology vendors. And I can tell you proudly that in India, we have our Lurgi-based technology, what it is there in the Angul. We have 80% of the equipments are being localized. We have got a beautiful machinery unit in Raipur, wherein we have localized 80% of the machinery, which is going to the coal gasification unit. Just to give you a flavor of how the forex saving will be happening, since I am from the steel industry, so I'll talk about the steel, not on the petrochemical things. So syngas can be produced at a variable cost of $5 per MMBTU. And if you can take the total cost, like, the interest, depreciation, investments and all, it can be produced at $7. If Government of India will be supplying coal at ₹0.45 per megacal. So that can be possible. As of now, the CIL is supplying at around 55 or 60 paisa per megacal, which we foresee that they will be supporting the coal gasification by supplying at ₹0.45 per megacal, and which will be much cheaper. As you have seen that for last 3 years, the natural gas prices was, if we'll take the average of last 3 years, it will be $16 per MMBTU. Definitely it has gone down to the level currently because of the COVID and all. But since it is a longer kind of period, so we have taken 3 years. So as against the $16 per MMBTU, we can produce around $7 per MMBTU. If Government of India will assist by reducing the availability of coal at 40 paisa per megacal. So just to give you an example, currently we are having a capacity of 130 million ton of steel capacity in India, and we are producing around 110 million ton per annum. If 30% of the steel will be produced through CGP-DRI route, the potential forex saving will be $3.5 billion. And government has given us a vision by 2030, we have to increase the steel capacity by 300 million ton. And if we'll be producing around 30% via CGP group, so the forex saving potential will be around $9 billion. So that's what the simple math is. So I just wanted to conclude here. So what are the kind of support? So coal can be used for its chemical energy. Coal, what we believe is the mother nature has bestowed a lot of resources to us. And we are unnecessarily burning it for power generation. We believe the coal can be used for its chemical energy rather than the thermal energy. This chemical energy can be utilized to produce a lot of value-added product, what we highlighted in the earlier slide, rather than just burning it and creating a harm to environment just for the sake of thermal energy. So the second point is the to give impetus on the coal gasification industry and attract a lot of investment in this particular area. So we believe that government should further set up a national policy on coal gasification, which will be one window, which will be, you know, driving the whole whole projects. As Prime Minister has already given a $100 million coal gasification unit. So that project should be driven fast, and there should be one window under national policy on coal gasification. The third point is that currently we are utilizing the coal, thermal coal, largely into the power sector, which is a regulated sector. And CIL is supplying coal, thermal coal, through the linkage at a price of regulated sector. So since this particular utilization of thermal coal will be utilized for gasification, which is much cleaner and greener way of utilizing the coal. So we believe that government should extend 20% lower price as compared to the regulated sector. So coal should be provided for gasification 20% lower than the regulated sector coal prices is. So that's number one. And already government has offered 20% discount on revenue sharing basis for coal gasification and liquefaction in soon to be conducted commercial coal mining. So there is all the way more reason that they should supply the coal to the for the gasification. If I don't have the mines, I should be getting coal at a 20% lower prices than the regulated sector prices. Then getting coal from single source, that's very important point, because most of the success of the coal gasification technology is that it will be designed with respect to a particular mine where there will be a kind of homogeneous kind of, you know, coal available, and the feedstock, there will not be any variation in the chemical property of the coal. So it is all the way more a reason that, you know, that should be coal should be supplied to any gasification unit from the single source. And to do that, there should be a preferential allotment of a particular gasification unit, one mines or two mines, so that there should not be any variation in the coal, specification. The other point is the GST compensation says of 400 rupees, whether we are importing coal from outside or, you know, we are procuring coal from CIL or anybody else, we have to pay GST compensation says of 400 rupees per metric ton. So that is the major, you know, that is the major inhibitor for the development of this kind of technology, because GST compensation says being non-GST compliant, it has become a cost to the producers. Like for JSPL, we have to incur 400 rupees and it will be added as a cost element in our whole, you know, economics. So that is major point which is inhibiting the kind of, you know, economics and viability, commercial viability of this kind of project. So that should be waived off for coal gasification. We are also, since we believe in this particular technology, currently because of the scarcity of coal or, you know, right quality of coal, we are operating at 40% of the capacity. If we'll be assured supply of coal from a single sources, we can invest in the downstream projects, and we can even go for, you know, in the next cycle of the CapEx, where we will be increasing our capacity, will be going for the coal gasification again. The second last point is that you know, a successful, like in India, we are frequently visited, our coal gasification unit is frequently visited by lot of international and national dignitaries. It is a case study being studied by the Indian technology institution, foreign technology, in when the Harvard people came to see and they have wrote a case study. So of late, this is a kind of role model. We have demonstrated the technology to the whole world that by gasification, steel can be produced. By gasification, other downstream facility can be installed. So we are hosting a lot of dignitaries. And a lot of people are calling us that we'll try to visit this, and they are interested in investing. So JSPL unit, that is a kind of role model here in India. And a successful and profitable CGP will always invite a lot of confidence to other investors. So at currently we are operating at 40%. So it's all the way more reason that government should support this gasification and the JSPL's CGP plan, so that the it will be running smoothly, it will be running under the 100% capacity, and which will be a kind of, you know, role model and originally kind of example other to follow. The last point is that we should have a senior officer from Coal Ministry who will be the one window who will be driving the whole thing, coal gasification things. So that's what from my side. And if you have got any questions, I am happy to take those questions.
Thanks, Arunesh. That was a wonderful presentation. Yes. I will come straight to the last point which you have mentioned, to have one dedicated man. I think I am already available for the country as a dedicated man for 12 years for coal gasification. And if the government wants votes, I can almost give what 1,500 to 2,000 votes from the industry. Yeah.
So nice of you, Ashwinji. In fact, we have started, as I told you, we have started from 2000, and all the way we have got some good well wishes.
I started getting the votes right now.
Thank you.
I started getting the votes right now. The audience is getting the votes right now.
Yeah.
Let's break the jokes apart. Be serious, and we would take it forward further. We have some problem with the network connections of Mr. Vivek Taneja. Can you just stop sharing your screen, Arunesh?
Yeah, sure. Thank you very much.
Yeah. We have some problem facing with Vivek Taneja's connectivity. There's some firewall issue and I'm not able to take him online. So in the meanwhile, we'll take some questions from the other participants. If there are questions, I would request everybody to raise hands and I will take them on stage. So that, I started with the first question. Mr. Raman, you have...
Good afternoon.
Dr. Raman, who this question is for?
This question is for about the coal gasification.
Arunesh.
Yes. It was a very good presentation on the coal gasification. Only thing, anyway, I am also working on biomass gasification. Biomass gasification, you know, it's not even reached that 1 megawatt level. The maximum single system is 250 kilowatt, and we go on the gasifier which you have shown is very large capacity. Are you also working on the smaller scale for a megawatt or 100 kilowatts level, 200 or 500 kilowatt level? Because biomass supply chain and coal supply chain, if you see, coal supply chain is much simpler to adopt. That is one of the things. And the second point which I am telling you, what type of gasifier you use when you say that downdraft or cross-draft, and that is one thing, type of reactor. And then the quality of the gas, I will use this thing beyond the steam actually. Is it suitable to run IC engine or gas turbines?
So to address your queries, Dr. Raman, we are not here to, you know, because we are from the industry and all the way whatever we do is in the large scale. So we are not actually, you know, pondering upon the smaller unit as of now. And the unit what we are as of now, we are yet to reach the full capacity. As I told you, is running around 40-45% capacity. So we first of all try to make it 100%, and then and the stage of, you know, CapEx cycle will be installing more gasifier. And we believe that government under visionary leadership of Prime Minister Modi will make it happen to encourage this gasification. Second point is that the biomass can be possibly, you know, used, because in China, what we have seen that the biomass is being, you know, gasified again. And by way of cleaning and all those things, that can be utilized in the downstream industry.
Okay. Now, I would request others to have some questions with regard to WHRP.
So, Ashwinji, the last point from my side, through your platform, I would request that if anybody from the industry would like to visit our Angul gasification unit to see the facility, we'll be happy to host them in our Angul plant. And to you, and of course, the always invitation goes to you too, that you should come and visit, since you are associated with this journey so long. So we'll be happy to host you and our Angul plant, and also to the industry participants, whoever is willing to see the plant running.
Thanks, Arunesh, for the invite. I'm not a technical man to invest, you know, come and understand. But anybody who would like to, you know, go to JSPL plants and visit, they can drop me an email. I would make the arrangement. That's not a problem at all.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot.
I'm most welcome and available for everyone 24/7 for the country.
Thanks a lot.
I will take the question of Ananda Reddy here. Ananda Reddy is a WHR person from KCP Cement. He has a question.
Hello.
Yes, Mr. Reddy.
My question to Govindra Sam. What is the efficiency of the WH boiler? What is the life of the boiler?
Being efficiency, the point we are talking about in WHRB, first of all, it's not the right word. Because you are going to give certain heat energy inlet of boiler. The outlet heat energy, it defined many factors. Because when you are going out, the temperature of PH boiler or AKC boiler, something around 160 or 180, it is fixed for your process requirement. If that is the case, if you want to define the efficiency, literally radiation loss 1% going to happen and blowdown 0.5 to 0.75. Even I can say 2% only total loss and total efficiency will be 98%.
Mr. Reddy, if you have any you know, further question, you can unmute yourself.
Yeah. What is the life of the AQC boiler?
Life of the AQC boiler, normally 15 to
because
20 years.
Because it is a very abrasive nature, na, the clinker gases.
Absolutely right. That is what I explained, the tapping is the important in the cooler. How much flushing is happen in your cooler is important factor to decide the life of the boiler. If the flushing frequently happen in your cooler, then life of the boiler come down. But we are supplying the boiler very much taking care of internal integrated pre-dust collector, which will going to collect 65 to 70% of the dust. After that, we are having the sacrificing tubes and channels, which will protect the surface, heating surfaces. So literally, I can say that technology we are offering more than 15 years will be there for abrasive nature.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
Okay, I have a next question from Mr. Arunachalam from Dalmia Cement, Assistant General Manager. I'm taking him a call.
Yeah, good afternoon to all. This question is to Mr. Gladstone, sir.
Yes.
Sir, you have referred in your PPT, there is some possibility there to recover heat from a rotary kiln surface. I just want to know, is there any references in India or in the globe having such installations?
Yeah, see, as I told you, it is only in a research scale. Some few vendors are available, but as of now, the economics doesn't work out. So there is no installation as of now.
Okay, sir. Actually, in Dalmia, we had we have experienced such projects in our Kadapa plant, where okay. We found it was not good that as the supplier has guaranteed. So that's what I asked. Any references, sir? We can explore it further.
Yeah, see, theoretically, it is possible to, I mean, extract heat. And if you have a CPP, that will be a better... maybe you can replace the LP heater or HP heater by means of providing some panels, radiation panels. Theoretically possible, but the thing is, it's a bit costly because since it's a very low temperature heat.
It's a very low temperature heat. What we in fact explored is to have a, we plan to have a VAM instead of using this.
Yes,
in-
yes.
But yeah, still, we couldn't be able to get the required temperature to operate the VAM.
Okay. What type of system you have implemented?
It's a tube panel, as you shown in your sketch.
Okay.
We, I think, some 70 TR VAM capacity we were thought to install, but instead of getting 90 degree temperature, we would get up to 60 degree only. So we couldn't able to operate the VAM on continuum.
That panel which you have installed is insulated outside?
Yes, sir, it is insulated outside.
Okay. Maybe we can see, if you can give some more detail on that, we can study if there any possibility to improve the, heat pickup.
Glad, sir. Sorry, interpret. Venkatakrishnan. Arunachalam, that profile, yes, you are placed, it was a flat profile or parabolic? It's a flat or parabolic?
It's a flat profile.
Actually, that is a flat. The initial stage of studies is a flat. That was a failure model. Nowadays, the second generation parabolic has came. You may think about that manner. That will be a better advantage.
Yeah, parabolic will be better because you can recover heat in all 280 degrees of heat you can recover.
Okay. Further discussion can proceed on the mobile app of Mission Energy Foundation, which is going to be there for a year's time. All the participants, I request to get connected because this is an app where we are building a community of the power producers together. So I would like to request everyone to be on the app, network with each other. I'll take the next question from Dinesh Jagatia.
Mr. Govindraj, sir.
Dinesh Jagatia is the general manager from Heidelberg Cement. Please, sir, go ahead.
This question is from Mr. Venkatakrishnan Govindraj, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, I want to ask you that you were saying that cooler boiler life is around 10 to 15 years, but what it depends on the flushing of the kiln also, as you said. Is there any observation out there that superheater which is installed lowermost portion which get hot corrosion or anything, is there possibility in the system?
Right, sir. Your question, I understand. There are a few mistakes.
We lost the connectivity of Mr. Govindraj. Gladstone, would you like to answer the question?
Yeah, see, this normally in a AQC boiler, vulnerable part is your superheater. That is the first stage where the hot gas is going to enter. So maybe that a proper low velocity design has to be done, and with the sacrificial tubes or some arrangement is available. If all those things are available, maybe your life will be better. But your downstream life will be much better than the superheater. But superheater, first row alone, maybe we may require frequent replacements.
Sir, it is agreeing to you, but the fins which have been provided on the first stage of the tubes, that has been eroded and the thickness has become like a paper one only. It is just eroded and it can be removed by hand itself only. Is it because of corrosion we are facing out there, or what it is there, sir?
See, it is only, I don't think it's because of corrosion, because since it is a high erosive dust, the first one or two tubes alone, it gets eroded faster. So the first two tubes alone, frequent replacement is required.
Okay.
I have a special guest, the managing director of JSPL, V.R. Sharmaji. He has some thoughts and views to discuss. Sharmaji, namaskar.
Thank you. Namaskar. How are you?
Good, sir. All well, with your blessings.
Good. It's good that you have taken up this particular task. Coal gasification, usage of coal. What is we are going to do in the country? It's a talk of the town. Thanks to the Prime Minister who has driven the momentum, and he is very keen that at least 100 million ton coal should be gasified in the country. And we had on 31st, there was a webinar called by Ministry of Mines, where Mr. Prahlad Joshi was also there, and they have committed that they will when Government of India will be doing or will be gasifying about 100 million ton coal. I think this time has come now. We started coal gasification in plant installation in 2008-2009. We completed our project in 2014. And now the plant is running. We are gasifying coal and coal to syngas and then syngas to DRI. So it's the first time in the world that DRI is being produced through the coal, and that too, the Indian coal, which is very highest coal. Of course, at the moment, we are washing this coal. So this coal is basically containing about 51-52% of ash. So what we do, we use washery and we wash it down to 34-35% of ash level. And then we have fixed bed gasifiers. So we are gasifying it. This is basically technology from Lurgi. And Sasol have been using this technology for the last 45 years. There are put together more than 500 gasifiers of like this in the world. And China alone is having more than 300 gasifiers of this kind of technology where we can use high-ash coal. So there are a lot of benefits what we are getting. So today, because coal, we don't have any coal mines. We are buying coal from Coal India. So, but we are sitting at the pit head of coal under, in the vicinity of our plant. There is about 100 billion ton of coal, say in 50 kilometers to 70 kilometers of the total radius. So what we are proposing to Coal India and to Government of India, that, you know, coal, having coal mines is one area, one interest. But let us not get into coal mines. Let Coal India or Government of India supply coal, or they should put up the gasification units at the pit heads. Today, transporting coal is a big hassle. And then transporting back the fly ash, that is again a big hassle. So what we are proposing to Government of India and Coal India to put up the gasification plant, either underground gasification or surface gasification or coal bed methane, wherever it is available, and then transport it to the pipelines and give it to the steel plants, those who are going to reduce iron ore or pellets to make DRI or sponge iron. Then similarly, they can supply this syngas to the people, those who are interested in PVC and plastics, those who are interested in making API for the medicines, drugs, what we are importing today, those who are interested in consuming it to the last mile of hydrocarbons to the olefins, those who want to put up a smaller or medium-sized fertilizer plants, and also to those who are interested in converting coal gas into methanol. So there are numerous products what we can get from coal. God has given, God is kind, who has given a lot of coal to Indian territory. And up till now, people were running behind the coal. But in last 5 years, the situation has changed because nobody wants coal now. Because most of the multinational companies, they are moving away from coal. And coal-based technologies, people, they don't prefer. But the only way that coal can be used in an environmental friendly way is the gasification. So coal burning in open in boilers will not be required in this country after say 15, 20 or 30 years. I would say the dead end may be by 2050. But coal through gasification, coal to liquid, coal to diesel, coal to petrol, coal to benzene, coal to olefins, coal to fertilizers, coal to power through syngas will be always used if a affordable technology is devised. So the technology what we are using is affordable, quite affordable. If today Coal India gives us the coal at a price with a minimum profit, then we can compete the imported natural gas maybe at $5 or maybe less than $5 per MMBTU. Secondly, the self-reliant Bharat, if you want to make natural gas, we don't have in India, we have to import. So if you want to make self-reliant India, then the best way is to use your own coal, convert into gas. Sometimes people, they ask question that the gas may be available at $3 or $4, but it was not the case 10 years back. KG Basin gas was, the price tag was $12 per MMBTU. The Tapi gas line, which was coming, Government of India signed an agreement, but the Pakistan did not allow the gas pipeline to come through Pakistan. It was Turkmenistan and Pakistan, India, Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, India, which was supposed to be terminated at Bathinda. So this was again $12.20 per MMBTU. Today's situation is changing because of the world recession and world economies are moving in different direction. But we are not talking for 2 years, 3 years, 4 years. We are talking for the next 20, 30, 40 years, maybe up to 2100. So in such a way, we have 350 to 400 billion ton of coal available in the country. So this coal, it was lying since millions of years. And then it will continue lying for another millions of years if we don't utilize it. The next generation will not use coal as a coal, but always use coal as gas. So the only solution is to convert coal into gas, synthesis gas, and then use synthesis gas wherever you want to use, whether you want to use for a pipe gas to the house to make it SNG or to convert into fertilizer or to convert into power, electricity, whatever. Then today, whatever Government of India, the Coal India is extracting about 750 million ton coal, but we import about 250 million ton of coal, that is thermal coal. So since the thermal coal which is being imported, it has ash contents of hardly 17% maximum. So, and the calorific value goes as high as 5,800 to 7,000. So in a way, these 250 million ton of coal will equalize to about 500 million ton of domestic coal. So India, they want to make India self-reliance and fully Atmanirbhar. Then they should ask the coal miners in India, whether private or public, to do a mining of about 2 billion ton per year. Because 2 billion ton coal will be equivalent to around 1400 to 1500 million ton coal or as of now, which will equalize, say, 1,000 million ton will be the demand in the country, domestic coal, and another 500 million ton equivalent, what is being substituted by imports. So it is 1,500, that is 1.5 billion. Over and above, there is a growth of about 10 to 12% in the consumption. So in next 3 to 4 years' time, we need 2 billion ton of coal, domestic Indian coal, either directly used or through the gasification. This is what we should do. The another factor is, since God has gifted us this these assets, today the power cost is very high in the country. Today power is ranging from 3 rupees, 3 rupees 50 paisa, to 14 rupees in many of the states. So power, you know, it has a very different calculation. We have to see that what is the total value of the bill per month to a industry when it is built. So if you divide the number of units consumed and versus the total money, so the total amount of bill divided by number of units, then it comes to 10 rupees in Tamil Nadu, 12 in Maharashtra, 10 rupees in UP, and another, say, 10 rupees in Delhi, 8 rupees in and 8 rupees in Rajasthan. So if we convert coal into gas and get power, then the people sitting in Rameshwaram, they can get power at 3 rupees 50 paisa. Kashmir to Rameshwaram, Kashmir to Kanyakumari, our power cost should not be more than 3 rupees 50 paisa or maximum 4 rupees. To reach to 4 rupees, we have to generate power at maybe 1 rupees 20 paisa or 1 rupees 40 paisa. That is possible when we use this coal in a fastest manner and better manner, environmental friendly manner. There are many people, those who say that mining is a very bad business. Yes, it is bad business if it is not managed properly. Prime Minister in 2019, October 2019 in America, he told all these things that we want to go underground, we want to go for coal bed methane, we want to go for coal gasification to protect the environment and to protect agriculture land above the surface of the coal. So these all are possible. So what we do, we are now requesting, discussing with multinational companies, those who have the specialty in converting coal into gas either to on surface or underground or through CBM. This is the right time for the country to ponder upon on this technology. Then another area which is most important today, all of the refineries, they produce pet coke. So we have tried out pet coke in our gasifiers. We can blend about 20 to 30% or maybe 40% of pet coke, and that can give an immense amount of CO, hydrogen to CO. So we need 55 to 56% hydrogen, and we need around 30% of carbon monoxide to be used as a reductant, and that is perfect blend. So whatever pet coke our petroleum refineries, they are producing, that can also be used very efficiently. Then another area is used tires. So we have also tried used tire. We shredded the tires and we put in our gasifiers, and we found very good results. So tire size of say 10 to 50 millimeter, if it is shredded, and then all these used tires, the steel is removed, the steel wires are removed during shredding. There is an automatic process. The tire is shredded and there is a magnetic separator which removes the steel wires. And all these tires, they can be converted into a syngas. So we have mixed three different mix we have done. 80% coal, Indian coal, 20% tires. Then we had done 50% coal, 30% pet coke, 20% tires. Then we had done 50% tires, 50% coal. Then we have done 50% pet coke and 50% Indian coal. All the results are perfect. And the economics that settles very well with these permutations and combination. So there has to be a policy in place so that the used tires, they are not, neither they are exported nor they are again converted into the black carbon. They should be gasified because they can give a lot of value in terms of energy. We have, the India is having abundant rubber plants, rubber fields. The untapped area in India, which is untapped so far, that is Meghalaya and Tripura. Tripura, Meghalaya, Manipur, Nagaland, this is a land which is very fertile for the rubber plants. So these rubber plants are there, the rubber, but the, unfortunately, there are no users, no taker. Now Bangladesh is putting a lot of many tire plants in Bangladesh, and they are going to bank upon the Indian rubber from Northeast. Similarly, all the Northeast areas, they are full of limestone, and also the high calorific value, but a little higher sulfur coal. So this coal is not being utilized. So what we have proposed to Government of India, that Bangladesh is a very friendly country, and we should have a corridor from Kolkata to Agartala via Bangladesh, a dedicated freight corridor of about 350 kilometers that will cut down the journey of the Indian trucks or Indian railway by 24 to 36 hours. And this will bring a huge natural assets from natural minerals from northeastern states to the central India, which is now they are deprived of selling their goods because they cannot transport it. Transport cost is very high. The Indian railway network is also very poor in the hill areas, especially up to Nagaland, Aizawl, etc. So the moment we connect it through Bangladesh with a dedicated corridor, then India and Bangladesh both can gain immensely from this kind of arrangement. So we have already discussed with the Government of India. We have given a proposal how to utilize the natural resources of Seven Sisters of India and how to make them grow to a different level. So all these things, there are so many permutations, combinations in the country. Country can definitely be self-reliant in energy, and God has given us enough. Sometimes we always cry that we don't have anything in the country. So we have too many things in the country. Then another point is, last point, I will not take much of time. The core sector industry in the quarter one, the growth has been negative, but nothing to worry about. Please don't see the quarter one, see the quarter two. We must always see that what is happening, what is good happening in the country. So the quarter one was very bad. Of course, GSPL has done very good. So we have made a net profit and we could reduce our debts also. But as a whole, the country has suffered. So let us delete those 2.5 months or 2 months time from our balance sheet for a time being. And let us start consuming more and more general goods so that the economy starts rotating. So if we rotate the economy, so it depends upon all of us. We have to rotate the economy. We have to increase our consumptions, whether it is a household consumption or it is industrial consumption, we have to increase. The moment we increase the consumption, the country will pick up and we will definitely defeat the predictions of many of the international rating companies that India will be in a net loss situation. So I'm sure India will come up. The next 7 months time for the Indian industry is going to be a very golden time. I'm sure whatever is happening on the border, government of India will tackle, and a good sense will prevail in Chinese government and their decision makers, and they will definitely cool down their stand and will not try to provocate Indian troops. So let us hope for the best, and let us hope that we become a part of utilizing our natural resources to the last molecule of carbon. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. I just have one sentence to say. Hamara desh sone ki chidiya thi, sone ki chidiya hai, aur hamesha sone ki chidiya rahegi. Jai Hind, sir. With this, I would like to take a break for the session. I invite Sharma ji to come to the networking lounge, which we have arranged the virtual tables there. On the virtual tables, you can sit any of the chairs and you can virtually meet all the participants together. That's the beauty of this technology we have brought.
Very good. Let me order my coffee.
Yes, sir.
And then I'll sit on the table.
I will have coffee with you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.